Welcome to the virtual Royal June session. Now, it is the goal and the purpose of these sessions to try to stay in touch with all the celebrities and the outstanding riders of show jumping and the ladies of sport is sort of our theme over the next few sessions that we're going to enjoy. And with me today, very, very honored and privileged to have a rider who has been competing in the Grand Prix classes since, believe it or not, 1984, and actually has appeared at the Royal many, many times. We're going to talk about that. She is a new member of the Show Jumping Hall of Fame, 10-time Rider of the Year in the United States. She's been to the Olympics, Pan American Games, medaled in the World Equestrian Games, and she has a catalog of jokes that will just make you laugh forever and ever, but we can't talk about those jokes on the air today. But anyways, and she's a great poker player, and I'd like to welcome and thank you, Margie Engle, for spending some time with us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, virtually with a great introduction like that, I think our listeners might be interested in how you spent the last year, like everybody else, trying to figure out what to do with showing and COVID and staying home, not staying home, and just kind of enlighten us a little bit on what you, how you spent actually the, what would be the last 14 months.
Actually, it's been kind of nice. Luckily in our sport, we always have something to do with the horses. We weren't able to still come out and work them at the farm, and we were outdoors and we could social distance and still spend plenty of time with the horses and in the stable, and we got to work with them and got to do some trail riding, some bonding, some working on different exercises at home, working on the rideability and the flat work. And I kind of enjoyed the time spending with the horses at home. It was kind of like in the olden days when we didn't have so many horse shows week after week, but it was a challenge to work on what your show schedule was, for sure. I mean,
I hear you there. And I think it touched everybody basically, and always curious on how everybody dealt it on an individual basis. So the connection you have with the Royal Winter Fair, I want to just reflect a little bit on that. I'm not sure if you can remember when you were actually first started showing up there. I know you showed at the Nations Cup in 1996. Can you talk a little bit about our great Royal Winter Fair horse show?
Actually, it's my first Nations Cup I ever did there, and it was in 89, and I had Salute. I remember it very well. It was one of my fondest memories in the equestrian world, and I was the first time I had competed, I think, out of the United States, and it was the first time I had been to Canada, and I went with Salute, a stallion who was one of my favorite horses that I've ever ridden, and I got to be on my first Nations Cup there, and I was the anchor rider, and luckily he kind of pulled through and was super there, and it's just an unbelievable feeling going to that horse show. It's the atmosphere is like none other indoor show that I had been to at that time. It was kind of like Canada's Madison Square Garden, but even up a notch, because everyone was so dressed up, and you got a feeling of the crowd behind you was sold out every night. And it was a great feeling to go into that ring and the atmosphere there, and having, you know, riders that we usually don't get to spend much time with. We only had a couple classes a day, and back then we showed, I think, for almost 2 weeks, 10 or 12 days. So it was a long time to be there, and the town in Toronto is fantastic. And I got to go look around at the fair and see all the different things there that were quite interesting. And it was a lovely event.
Well, I knew you probably like to see all the different animals and all the ducks and the geese and the cows and so forth. And the whole, you can't beat the atmosphere. And I know you've been around the world, and I know that since the days that the Royal went for, actually the show jumping went for 10 or 12 days, it seemed like more than that. It has been narrowed down, and it still has a great atmosphere. And I think, as you can reflect, maybe up to that last couple, 2 or 3 years, when you have appeared there, just with the newer venue and so forth, just a great feel there, right?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they've made great improvements. There's more space to ride in indoors. Before, we had to go, you know, we went down the street and it was freezing cold. I remember I saw, I think, my first snow there, and it was in November. And it was, for me, it was real snow. Other people, if it didn't stay on the ground for very long, it wasn't. But it was about as cold as I had ever been coming from Miami. But the improvements are fantastic. They still get a unbelievable crowd there, and they're all enthusiastic. They know all the riders. They know the history behind all your horses, and it's just a great feeling about it. The going in and seeing all the different, I never knew any so much about cows and about butter sculptures and about big squash and things like that. There were things I had never seen. I saw so many different types of chickens and roosters. It just, I learned a lot while I was there too about a lot of different things.
Well, it certainly is one of the greatest in the world. And just as a transition into, you talk about many of your great horses that you've had. I mean, I date myself back to watching you ride Puck W and Daydream and some of the early ones. Just take us on maybe a little magical history tour through some of your great horses. And I think I'd be interested to know probably if you have a favorite one or two of all time. Maybe not. Maybe you love them all. So,
you know, it's like asking you what, you know, your favorite child is or something, or favorite relative. I have been very fortunate to have so many nice horses. And Daydream was, of course, the first really competitive horse I had at the Grand Prix level, and he was only 6 years old and I didn't know the difference, and I put him in, he did all the big classes for me, and he was actually the first horse I showed at the Garden. And Puck W was a horse I rode really almost by default. I think nobody else wanted to ride him, but I enjoyed him, and he was the first horse I think I was able to show at the higher level because no one else really wanted to do him. He was a very strong horse, and he was kind of different looking. I had ridden mainly thoroughbreds at that time, and he was about as far the other spectrum from a thoroughbred that you could see. He was very large horse. His head was probably bigger than my whole body. And most of the horses I rode back then were catch rides and horses that when they got to the level of doing the upper level, they either got sold or the owners would take them back. They just sent them to me for training or for to try and sell them or to correct different things. And he was probably one of the most difficult horses I had shown in the jumpers, but he could jump, and I was happy to be able to have something that jumped over big jumps. So when we weren't getting run off with, and then he was very careful, and he did have a lot of jump to him. It just took quite a bit to get him to steer around the courses and not kind of run off. And my Daydream was fantastic for me for many years. Same with Salute and Sebastian, and those are the ones from a long time. I had a bunch of grays, probably 8 to 10 grays at that time doing the Grand Prix level. Hearsay, Apple King, Land of Kings. There were a lot. So, and then I was very fortunate later with a lot of good horses, and a lot of Hidden Creek's Perrin, Hidden Creek's Laurel, Alvaretto, and now Royce and Deacon. It's just so difficult to name just one. You have different horses at different periods in your life, and you love them all.
I'm sure your driver's license mentions or says that you are 4'11" in height, and you seem to be on these gigantic horses. You always had most of the tallest horses in the class. Was there any reason for that or any background behind that?
No, actually my driver's license says 5'1", but I'm probably just under. I'm not as short as I appear, but I do ride. It was just what I was sent. They weren't necessarily horses I picked out. When I started, people sent me a lot of big horses. I don't know how. And then you get the reputation. That's what you should, you know, you liked. And they were mainly horses that different professionals and dealers sent me to sell. And they remembered those because they were so large. But I rode a lot of normal size horses. Alvaretto was not a big horse. Laurel was not really that tall. She was more of a thoroughbreddy type. Indigo was probably more like 16'2". It's just people remember the large ones. And I did get sent quite a few big ones.
Tell us a little bit about when you go back to all those horses way, way back. I know at a time you were actually had two show jumping strings on the road. You were the busiest rider in all of show business, and you would actually try to compete in maybe two events every week. You had horses in two locations, had a great training group, great group behind all of you. What was that like? I mean, you, when I first got into business, you were riding 4, 5, 6 horses in every Grand Prix.
Yeah, it was funny. When I first started, I think I was so hungry. Anything that someone would send me, I would, and they wanted it in the Grand Prix, I would try and ride them in them. And most of them, when they sent them to me, were 4, 5, and 6 years old. So those horses weren't ready to do the bigger shows. So I would have the ones that were a little more experienced go to the bigger shows, and the ones that are a little less experienced that people wanted in Grand Prix and have a shot to go in some bigger classes, they were at another show. And I was very fortunate to have a lot of good Grand Prix horses at the time. So I did split them up a little bit because, as you said, it's hard to ride 5 or 6 in one class. And also certain ones were capable of jumping at better venues than other and bigger venues and places. Like, I remember when I went to Upperville, I would send a couple that were capable of jumping that Grand Prix, which was difficult at the time. And then I was in Germantown with the younger horses doing the Grand Prix there the night before. So it was a little crazy trying to get from place to place. And that was, I didn't have my own private plane or anything. So there were a lot of miles up in the air flying from one place to the next, but I thought it was exciting and I loved riding them all. And it made me fortunate that people sent me a lot of different horses because they knew, I guess I was hungry enough to go all over the place to compete.
I know the audiences and the crowds loved seeing you come to a horse show, but I bet some of your fellow riders didn't when you brought 5 or 6, bullets for the ride in a Grand Prix. But that was always very exciting, and I think it was always fun to see that somebody actually could do that and have enough horses to go and compete in 2 events every week of the summer. I mean, it was just amazing, and you did it all at that time. Sort of segueing off all the great horses you've had, I know that you like to develop some young horses. It's quite a process, probably an even more expensive process nowadays. But what are your thoughts? Do you have anything coming up? I know that Royce probably is gonna, might be a year off, 2 years off, maybe finishing or whatever, a great career. Who knows? But do you have anything that's gonna come up in your mind?
It's hard to say. I have some young ones, and I'm not very good at making predictions. But I have some new ones that I'm bringing along and some other divisions at this time. Deacus is just kind of getting into his prime at this stage, and we'll just see what happens. I don't have as many as I had years ago. They, like you said, it wasn't as expensive to bring them along, and people sent me a lot of young horses, and I was very fortunate that time. And now they were much easier to buy back then. You could buy a prospect for at least a tenth of what you could these days. So people were willing to gamble a little bit more and buy horses to bring along. Now it's quite expensive to buy even a prospect that looks like it has potential. So I don't have as many potential horses, but I you're always looking. But so are thousands of other people at this stage. There's more people riding than ever now, and they're harder and harder to find.
Right, that's what I was going to say. It was a whole lot easier way back when to bring on a horse and develop it along. Do you like to try to push a horse a little bit more? Maybe if you know it has some potential and scope, do you think that it's a wise idea to move them up the ranks quickly, or are you a patient rider with kind of bringing horses along? I know it depends on the horse probably, but.
It's totally dependent on the horse's personality and depending on the owners of the horse. Now I'm in a little more fortunate position. I own part of a lot of the horses that I ride, so I'm able to be more patient with them. I think in the long run, you end up with a better horse if you're patient and establish, their basics and get them to trust you at the lower levels first and get the rideability correct, because the courses are way more technical than they were years ago. You could push a horse if it had scope and the ability to jump in the Grand Prix a lot earlier years ago, because the courses weren't as technical. And also most of the owners, that's probably why they sent me a lot of them, because they knew I was either dumb enough or or just took a shot and did them in the big classes earlier than they maybe should have. And luckily we got away with it with most of them, but a lot of them were 6 and 7 years old doing the Grand Prix. And I don't know that that's the best idea, probably not in the long run. And especially nowadays that the courses are more technical and you need more rideability for the horses. So I think in the long run, if you want your horses to ride better and be more competitive at the upper level, it is better to take your time.
Before we get into a couple of questions from our viewers, sort of pressing a button on the Wayback Machine, I'm just curious, when you were a little child, do you have any idea that you were going to do this for a living and spend every living minute on the road and everywhere? Did you ever think that?
I always, it's kind of something you kind of dream of, but you think is out of your reach, especially with my background. I didn't think I would, I never owned part of any horse till I was in my mid-20s. I think Daydream was the first horse I owned even a part of. So it wasn't something I thought that was possible, but it was always something that I dreamed to do and I really wanted to do. All I wanted to do was ride horses. And it was funny, the people that own the stable where I started said that I probably would have ridden a donkey if they gave it to me. I mean, any horse that, whether it was breaking the young ponies or horses or riding I rode a lot of the race horses and galloped them a little bit. Anything they asked me to ride, I just loved being around them. So to do it at this level and to travel all over, that kind of was just bonuses that came with it. But I used to ride back when I started, and I loved riding as many as I could, probably between 60, 70 rounds a day when I did both the hunters and jumpers.
Well, busy, busy, busy time. Well, we have a few questions, and I just see if you can help us out in answering a few from Eden, and this is from social media through our Royal Agricultural Winter Fair. If you were to be on an all-female Nations Cup team, what three women would you want to be on your team? They could be any country. They could be riders, past or present. I'm not sure if it would put you on a spot, but maybe you can come up with
that. That's a little bit putting me on the spot, but if I'm thinking current, and I'd like to stay with my own country, but I've been on a lot of teams with BZ and Laura and Lauren. I mean, there's tons of other top riders, but we've been on a lot of teams together, and I don't know that I can name. It's hard to narrow it down. You're putting me in a bit of a spot, just like with your favorite horse. I mean, there's so many good riders, and there's a lot of good women riders all over the world too. I mean, it's not just our country. Probably started with more women than other countries, but you still have so many other countries now with top women riders, with Penelope from France and Edwina, and I mean, I'm sure I'm leaving people out, but there's top women and female riders all over the world.
I couldn't agree with you more on that. From Lynn, and you might have already covered this, but maybe just assess it again. Did you ever have that one breakout moment? If so, when and what was it? Can you think about that?
I don't know that I would say it was a special breakout moment. I was just excited to be able to compete and ride when I was starting and just even with the hunters and having top hunters and probably when I had Daydream, he was the first horse that I was able, my parents helped me syndicate him and put a limited partnership together. So he was the first upper level horse I was able to keep to campaign a little bit. We put a syndication together and I was able to show him in the Grand Prix for longer than a short period of time when they got sold or went on to other riders. So, and as a six-year-old, he won, which at the time there weren't that many horse shows, but he won, I think, 4 or 5 Grand Prix his first year. And probably the most exciting one for me was in Cincinnati. That used to be the next best class to me. It was in a football stadium in our country. Like the Invitational. The Invitational was the highlight for me, but Cincinnati was the next best thing. It was in a football stadium, and that was really exciting. And I didn't know much what I was doing, but he didn't either. And luckily he was double clean there and won. And it was probably one of the most exciting classes I did.
So from Maryland. To what two or three things would you most attribute your success to? Or maybe I could also add to the longevity. And don't tell us that you're a chiropractor or you're a doctor or whatever. So what would you, how do you kind of, you look back and you've been in it a long time.
It's been a long time, but you just, it's just a number. You just have to not think of the how many years, but you just, it's just something you have to just keep working at. It's just a lot of having a good work ethic. And as I get older, I do have to work out much more now than I did when I was younger. I have to work at it to be fitter than I did in the earlier years. And I guess just being a little bit stubborn, Mrs. Kramer used to tease me that the more they told me I couldn't do something with one and they try and get me not to ride one, I would just keep, it just made me think it was that more, much more of a challenge and work at it that much harder. And just kind of working through the hard times and seeing them more as challenges, not as something you couldn't do.
Isn't it interesting? It brings up a really good point. It's interesting that way back when you could just go out and get on a horse. Now you get on a horse. However, you have to really take better care of yourself. And you just brought that point up and trying to work out and stay in shape. And I would say quite a few of the riders are in tune to that. And is that something you just have done recently, or have you tried to do through most of your career?
Well, I grew up I was a bit of a tomboy. I had two older brothers and they worked out all the time and had weights in the house. So I, even when I was a young kid, because I wanted to play football when I was in elementary school. So they would let me play football or baseball with them. I used to work out when my parents weren't watching. That was before it was a good thing for women to work out. So I would sneak in their room and use their weights and work out. So I was trying to be fit enough to play football or baseball with them. And so it was something I think that I've always done since an early age, even before I got into the riding that much. But I think anything you do, you have to try and be pretty fit. And anything you do, you want to try and do to your best ability. And part of that is being fit and healthy.
Margie, just one other question from a viewer, from a social media fan, from Elizabeth. And again, trying to put you on the spot a little bit, but what is there a horse living, deceased, whatever, that you would have loved to have ridden in your life, in your career?
It's hard to say. There's so many nice horses, but one horse that was probably my favorite all time to watch, just because he was good with so many riders, and because he was bred as an American thoroughbred, was Gem Twist. He was, for me, it just gave me chills watching him jump. He put so much into every jump, and he was so enthusiastic, and with three different riders, he won the championships for the AGA, and he was just amazing to watch. And at the World Championships, he was with each rider when they switched horses. He was clean with every rider that went. He never lost his enthusiasm. He would almost crouch down like a cat and give everything just total respect. And to this day, I don't know if any horse gave me chills like it did watching him jump.
Well, you and everybody else, basically. And what can they, what can people do to make the best use of their training time while COVID and shut down competitions in various areas? I mean, you sort of alluded a little bit to what you have done with the program, but I know people are looking forward to getting back to normal and getting back out. I mean, things, obviously you got to do a lot of work at home, right? I mean, which you do.
Yeah, I think there's always something to do. You can always work on improving anything in your life, whatever your passion is. I think working out is a good way to start. I think spending time with your horses and learning more horsemanship, I think that is one thing that's a shame that we've gotten away from later years. When I started, whether you were more affluent or less affluent, you still spent a lot of time with the horses. You knew how to tack them up. You knew you wanted to spend time with them. You wanted to graze them. You wanted to get to know them and build a bond. And I see nowadays, I see kids not having enough time to spend with their horses and knowing them, and they're more on social media and those type of outlets. And I just think it's important to get to know your horses inside and out. I think it's important for your riding to improve if that's what you want to do. And anything you do, I think you have to try to do the best to your ability and know the most you can about your horses and horses in general.
And in bringing up young horses, I mean, you mentioned it takes a lot of time and a lot of patience and actually a lot of money to do what you want to do with young horses. I mean, is it worthwhile for the general person to try to do that, or just to basically try to have fun and go out and compete with something that's already made?
You know, that's totally an individual thing. I think if it's something you really want to do and you have the patience to do it, I loved working with the young horses. To me, they were like sponges, and every day they learn so much when they're young like that. And if you have the patience and time, I think it's one of the most rewarding things that I did, starting off and working with the babies and breaking young horses. As I've gotten older, I don't really know that I have as much time, and it is quite expensive. A lot of my young horses I do leave in Europe now, because it costs or way less to bring them along there than it does in our country, for everything from the board to the showing to all the expenses are way less over there to bring along the young horses. So I've been doing that more so the past few years, but I just think that's an individual thing. I think for some people, it's better to buy the ones that are a little more made up. And for most professionals, I think that if you start with them when they're young, most of the most success I've had with the horses are the ones I had since they were young, and you get to really know each other. They get to learn what your moves are. You get to know their moves. And it just, I think that it's the best combination when you both learn together.
Well, as we wind down this little discussion, one other thing I would love to know, and I'm sure some of our viewers would like to know, is there anything else beyond horses that you really enjoy doing? I mean, I know that they're probably 1,000% of your daily life, but are there other things that you do enjoy?
I enjoy pretty much everything. I mean, I love going to dinner with family and friends and spending vacation with my family. My family helps keep me grounded. None of them are horse oriented, so we don't really talk about the horses that much. And it's just kind of nice to sometimes get away for a little bit, and it leaves you fresher when you come back. And I love playing poker. That's another thing that I like to do with friends and family. Not so much it's just for the camaraderie, and just I like, you know, kind of talking with people, and it's more of a distraction from all the pressures in your life. It gives you some time to do something else. I like reading. I like anything to do with the water. I grew up in Miami, so we were on a small lake, and we kind of lived in, as a kid, I lived in the lake most of the time. So vacations on the beach, just, I like any kind of sports I like. But I like, you know, pretty much everything.
You do, you know, and, just as a final statement, it's nice, and hopefully we'll be able to all get back to normal real soon. I know that the masks are becoming optional in the States and so forth. And one great thing about you, it's great to see your smile again, because we haven't had a chance to see anybody smile. We're looking at people's eyes all the time. And I know we all wish for a better world. And I think we're right around the corner there. But
we just got to notice this morning that here in Kentucky, that if you've been vaccinated at the showgrounds, you don't need to wear the masks anymore. That just came in this morning. So I think we're headed in the right direction. And I can still tell when people are smiling a little bit by their eyes, either that or they've got big wrinkles, but either way, looks like they're happy.
Perfect. Well, Margie, thanks for spending. I know you got a busy schedule, and thanks for spending some time with us. And thanks everyone for watching. Actually, for the friends who missed tuning in, be available on our virtual platform until November, or you can find it on the Royals YouTube channel. And just to mention that the virtual experience takes place June 15th and 16th, 2021. And you can also join us for some great equestrian content, sitting down with Leslie Howard, Tiffany Foster, another two of our leading ladies in the show jumping sport, excellent videos and partnership with McKee Pownall Equine Services, featured topics in the three-part series, including bandaging your horse, a veterinarian's approach to lameness, rehabilitation from injury. Hope you had enjoyed a great time with one of our great friends and a celebrity on our show jumping tour. And Margie Engle, again, thank you very much.
It's an honor to have be on your show.